find you intimidating.
You should.
In Above Oblivion's Tide, There Is a Pier, celebrated American poet Emily Dickinson considers the appeal of literary fame.
Above Oblivion's Tide, there is a pier, and in a faceless few are lifted there, nay, lift themselves. Fame has no arms, and but one smile that meager spawns. Emily Dickinson.
There's just one problem. Emily Dickinson didn't write this poem. She wrote, well.
Content warning. This video discusses sensitive topics, including domestic abuse, stalking, and intimate partner violence. Your discretion is advised.
In 2005, first-time author Stephanie Meyer published Twilight, a young adult or YA paranormal romance novel. Meyer initially conceived the novel as a personal hobby project, joining the American Night Writers Association, an organization that at the time was an Arizona-based association of female, LDS, amateur, and semi-professional writers. After sharing the work with her friends and family, Meyer was encouraged to send the work to literary agents, and although the work was a little unusual by YA standards, she managed to get an agent to read it, help her edit it, and secure a bidding war among publishers. Twilight tells the story of Bella Swan, an introverted, bookish teenage girl who abruptly moves from Arizona to Washington to live with her father, an awkward, well-meaning police chief. At her new school, Bella struggles to fit in, but encounters a handsome, rude, standoffish boy in her class named Edward Cullen, and befriends a teenage Quileute boy from the nearby LaPush Reservation named Jacob Black. Bella is intrigued by Edward, who behaves in a confusing hot and cold way toward her, including saving her life twice, once from a car and once from a gang of rapists? Okay, we'll come back to that. Bella discovers Edward's secret, that he's actually a vampire, and that while he's attracted to Bella, his thirst for her blood makes him dangerous to be around.
This is the skin of a killer, Bella.
Even so, Bella and Edward fall in love, Edward and his family save Bella from some evil vampires, and Edward and Bella formalize their love for each other with the most romantic gesture of all, going to prom together. And it's okay. Especially for a first-time novelist, Meyer has a strong grasp of characterization, imagery, and genre. In particular, this is going to come up a lot, her viewpoint character, Bella, is fairly compelling. Introverted, bookish, and socially awkward, but also responsible, self-possessed, and observant. The relative strength of Bella's viewpoint does a lot of work, especially early in the series, to cover for how little she does in the story and how much her life revolves around having a crush on one guy. Ironically, this becomes an issue in the film adaptation. Kristen Stewart does a good job playing Bella as what she is, an intelligent, surly teenage girl who doesn't really fit in, but being outside her head just leaves you watching a surly teenager. Meyer's writing absolutely has flaws. It tends to be thematically unfocused, a little dull, droning in its prose, sometimes trite, while Twilight, which is focused so much on Bella's internal experience of her teenaged romance, obscures those flaws. I expect genre fans see those as normal features of writing in YA romance. It definitely comes to the fore in the books that follow, which transition from a decent YA paranormal romance to a kind of floaty urban fantasy that happens to feature characters that belong back in the romance novel they came from. So while Twilight isn't great, it's by no means very bad. I think a lot of the most obnoxious criticism has been clearly in bad faith. People coming in from outside of the genre and refusing to understand how that genre works, or how the fantasy elements of Twilight work. But there is some stuff we're going to have to come back to, and also, watching and then going back and reading Twilight, my brain kept sticking on a thought. An uncharitable one, and not a terribly incisive or relevant one. One you've probably heard before. One I want to interrogate, but one that stuck in my head nonetheless. Edward Cullen is immortal, and he's spending his eternity going to high school. On purpose. See, I know I'm not supposed to think of Edward that way. Edward is a vampire, yes, and immortal, but that direction of looking at his character, looking inward at Edward's vampirism and the way its ramifications inform his personality, isn't how the story is presented to us. Yes, technically he's a 100-year-old man hanging out in high school deciding he's falling in love with a teenager because he thinks she smells hot, but within the fantasy, and from Bella's perspective, we notice his hostility, then the torment under that hostility, and then the secret under that torment. The same secret that Elizabeth discovered about Mr. Darcy, that the Beast is actually a damaged, sensitive man, hostile only because he's been hurt before, a secret that normal people might not notice, but that something a special girl, like Bella, like the bookish, isolated teenage girl Twilight is made for, might be able to behold. That the vampire doesn't burn in the sunlight, he glows. But my brain did stick on it. Edward Cullen is immortal, and he's spending his eternity going to high school on purpose. It turns out you can't kill the author, not the whole way, even in literally the semi-coherent grocery aisle screaming fit masquerading as an essay.
We are now beginning to let ourselves be fooled no longer by the arrogant, anti-frastical recriminations of good society in favor of the very thing it sets aside, ignores, smothers, or destroys.
Where Roland Barthes tried to articulate that position, he didn't succeed, not even for a moment. Too busy fanboying over Proust to try to remove him from the narrative. There are a bunch of critiques of the model of the death of the author, some of them quite serious. That it overemphasizes meaning over every other part of a text. That it's unusable on its own and requires other arguments to be brought in to support actual criticism. But I want to pull on this. Reconstructing the intentionality of the author is a huge part, sometimes the enduring part of reading. It's so powerful an instinct that we take works created by hundreds of people and seek out a single creative manager so that we can place all that intentionality in their voice. And because that's true, all public communication, certainly all public artistic communication, becomes the act of constructing a public self, an impression of ourselves that we create in the audience's mind. When Stephanie Meyer writes Twilight, she constructs a public Stephanie Meyer, a person we feel has just told us a story, just as Erica Mitchell constructs an E.L. James when she writes 50 Shades of Grey, just as this video might make you feel that you have had a conversation with me, a fake person that you crafted together with also me, a real person that you probably have never met. Each of us constructing versions of ourselves that will last as long as the work that contains it. A kind of, if we can lift ourselves to that pier above Oblivion's tide, a kind of immortality. Bart and his followers fell back on a more reasonable, more incisive point. All artistic work is to some extent open, meaning it derives meaning, in part, from ambiguous symbolism. Imagery, juxtaposition, theme, reference, even techniques like meter or rhyme. Within reasonable limits, that means that meaning is arrived at when the reader, responding to that ambiguity, links those symbols together in a way that the author can try to manipulate but cannot entirely control. For example, Meyer must not have intended the reading, Edward Cullen is immortal, and he's spending his eternity going to high school, on purpose. But it is still a reading that emerges between the text and me. And if meaning is constructed with the audience's input, you can't leave them out of criticism. You have to study them too. Or, as Umberto Eco put it,
when I send a message, what do different individuals in different environments actually receive? Do they receive the same message? A similar one? A totally different one? Questions of this kind are common to all research in human communication, but they are particularly pressing in the field of mass communication.
Just as the Twilight I read isn't the Twilight that Stephanie Meyer intended, but is still sort of Twilight, well, the same is true of the Twilight that Erica Mitchell read. It's not the Twilight I read, it's not the Twilight Stephanie Meyer intended, but it is still, sort of, Twilight. In 2009, after the Twilight books had concluded and Wilder film adaptations were hitting screens, a British television production executive named Erica Mitchell, operating under the pseudonym Snow Queen's Ice Dragon, began posting a Twilight fanfic called Master of the Universe. In fanfiction terminology, Master of the Universe is an alternate universe or AU retelling of Twilight, recasting Edward not as a high school vampire, but as a billionaire businessman who likes a bit of bondage, and Bella not as a responsible, introverted high school student, but as a vapid, confused, thoroughly dislikable college senior. Over the course of hundreds of thousands of words of some of the worst written prose I've ever encountered, Mitchell elides away all of the character drama of Twilight in order to fit in just pages and pages and pages of the most repetitive, ponderous, stodgy internal monologuing, obsessing over the feature sets of cars, and mind-bogglingly stupid email conversations. As we'll discuss in the next section, it's important to understand what fanfiction is and to be careful about the ways in which one judges it. So, I don't want to be cruel about this, but I think it's important also to be clear. The biggest difference between Twilight and 50 Shades of Grey is that Stephenie Meyer is a fairly good writer, and Erica Mitchell is very bad. I pressed myself to find something positive to say about her writing, and here's what I've got. Her sense of setup and payoff is okay. She does sometimes seed story beats that eventually turn into something much later in the story. For example, she spends a long time fixating on a Volvo that her Edward buys her Bella.
I can drive the Volvo in high heels. At 12:55 precisely, I pull into the garage at Escala and park up in Bay 5. How many bays does he own? The Mercedes SUV is there, the R8, and two Volvo SUVs. I check my seldom-worn mascara in the light-up vanity mirror on my sunshield. Didn't have one of these in the Chevy. Go, girl. My inner goddess has her pom-poms in hand. She's in cheerleading mode.
A car that comes to be known as the Submissive Special because Edward buys it for all his subs. And that does pay off later when Edward buys Bella a different car to signify that they have an actual relationship. A scene in which Edward suggests that he's allowing her to choose a car she likes, but actually chooses the make, model, and configuration himself, though he does allow her to choose the color. Except that he rejects her two color choices and makes her choose between silver and white. Other than that, it's pretty bad. For example, Mitchell has a weakness common to novice writers, a discomfort with using the fastest narrative speeds, ellipsis or skipping ahead, and summary or summarizing. So everything gets narrated, and since everything happens in scene, every location is described, every going from one place to another is described, the methods by which they go from one place to another are described, the interiors of every car and helicopter are described, every goddamn stupid elevator ride is... Anyway, since everything that happens in Bella's life is narrated, A, the story moves at a crawl, and B, every event, whether sex scene or relationship trauma or Bella's exams, is relayed with the same narrative weight.
Holy crow, I'm hungry. I am daunted by his kitchen. It's so sleek and modern, and none of the cupboards have handles. It takes me a few seconds to deduce that I have to push the cupboard doors to open them. Perhaps I should cook Edward breakfast. He was eating omelette the other day at the Heathman. I check in the fridge. Plenty of eggs. Actually, I want pancakes and bacon.
Worse, Mitchell has no grasp of characterization. It's honestly kind of depressing how she takes Meyer's Bella, kind of a passive character and one whose life revolves around her male relationships, but one with a personality, goals, preferences, and an occasional incisive wit, in other words, an inner life, and just crushes her. Mitchell's Bella has no emotional maturity, identity, or self-awareness whatsoever, and only gives herself permission to feel things by constant reference to her inner goddess.
He glances at me out of the corner of his eye, and he gently blows out a deep breath. Oh, he's affected all right, and my very small inner goddess sways in a gentle victorious samba. The businessmen exit on the second floor. We have one more floor to travel. You've brushed your teeth, he says, staring at me. I used your toothbrush, I breathe.
A concept that Mitchell just uses to separate Bella from her own emotional state so that our viewpoint character, the character whose emotional state we would step into to access the story, does not directly experience her own emotions. And so, while Meyer's Bella is confused by Edward because Edward, concealing an impossible secret, is behaving in ways that don't make sense, Mitchell's Bella is confused by Edward because she's a moron. This might actually be the biggest challenge of talking about this subject. It's impossible to talk about Mitchell's characterization without using some of the words that get deployed by people who just don't like mass market fiction for women. Honestly, that's one of the reasons I've talked so much about Twilight's Bella here. It might show you that's not what I'm doing. Mitchell's Bella has no goals, desires, or preferences. The major conflict of the story is supposed to be that Edward wants a submissive and Bella wants a romance. But the conflict falls in on itself because Bella has no concept of the romantic relationship that she wants. There's no part of it that she wants that she's not getting. She wants the relationship that they already have. Edward obsessively controlling her behavior, enacting his sexual fantasies on her, and lavishing her with expensive gifts in compensation. But she wants Edward to agree to call it a romantic attachment, largely because that would make it more socially comfortable. In turn, Bella's inexperience, incuriosity, and total lack of personality all make Edward even creepier. A man who explicitly only finds Bella attractive because she has no goals, personality, willpower, or life experience. That's basically Master of the Universe. She's an idiot, he is an asshole. But it's important to keep some perspective. It's fan fiction. And what we haven't really discussed yet is whether it's really appropriate to bring these critical tools to a work of this kind. So, let's step back and talk about that. Here are three things I could tell you about fanfiction. I could tell you that all creative work is inspired by other work, and there's a long tradition of presenting direct adaptations as new work in even the most mainstream media. That this West Side Story is adapted from this West Side Story, okay, by me in America, and also informed by this West Side Story, everything free in America, which is also adapted from this West Side Story, for a small fee in America. This West Side Story is an adaptation of Romeo and Juliet, just like this Romeo and Juliet, this Romeo and Juliet, this Romeo and Juliet, this Romeo and Juliet, these Romeo and Juliets, and these Romeo and Juliets. That Romeo and Juliet is an adaptation of a stock story in Western literature that we can find as far back as Ovid's first century Metamorphoses, where it appears as the story of Pyramus and Thisbe, and that Ovid is himself recounting a Babylonian folktale so old that the generation that originated it is itself semi-mythological, that much published work is indistinguishable from fanfiction. And that would be sort of true. I could tell you that in our legal system, copyright isn't actually property, like a fundamental property right, but a legal qualification we created using property as a metaphor, and that this metaphor has been continuously twisted over centuries to the benefit of media corporations built atop monetizable IP libraries against the interests of both audiences and small artists.
Sing it, Sam.
Oh, you got baggage, lady.
That Disney has been making billion-dollar bets on movies starring comic book characters in the same moments it is deploying their legal teams to fight the estates of the actual creators of those characters seeking to regain those copyrights. That there's no creative separation, only a legal one, between a Disney Star Wars movie and any Kylo Ren fanfic you find online. That would be sort of true, too. I could tell you that Twilight clearly owes a huge debt to 90s vampire fiction, specifically the dynamic Buffy has with Angel in the first seasons of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, sanding off a lot of Buffy's awkward feminist deconstruction and replacing it with a more straightforward romance that many fans wanted and that the series never quite gave them. that show is itself a remake of the earlier film Buffy the Vampire Slayer, that film is a deliberate inversion of a whole lineage of teen horror movies, that Master of the Universe is just a link in a long chain of writers reformulating previous works around the specific aspects they respond to. And that would be, well, a little true. But those aren't what's important about fanfiction. What's important about fanfiction isn't that it's derivative. For really as long as published fiction has been a thing, there have been creative people making creative work, especially female and queer writers and artists who felt excluded by the publishing industry, its norms, and by the lack of recognized paths for people like them into the space. These people built ways of sharing their work separate from the attention of agents, publishers, and critics, small, informal communities where people would just make things for and with each other. In fact, this is the kind of community Stephanie Meyer first wrote Twilight for when she joined the American Night Writers Association and when she let her sister read her novel. In the late 20th century, through conventions and zines, these communities intersected with fan groups. And today, that loose intersection of people has coalesced together online. If you're some combination of young, bookish, creative, and socially isolated, and especially if you're a girl or queer, there's this place online where you can read a great deal and find welcoming people who will provide relatively quick, mostly positive feedback on your own amateur work. Such a place can be an intensely rewarding social refuge. It's not the only community like this. Cosplay, for example, comes immediately to mind. For people who feel socially distinct on other axes, similar kinds of communities exist. I've seen scholarly comparisons to video game modding, to Harley owners clubs, to early 2000s Apple fans. In this space, quality isn't really the point. Readers and writers evaluate quality, and there are vast gaps in skill. There are many, many writers who have barely any grasp of spelling, punctuation, or sentence structure, let alone characterization, symbolism, or plotting. And there are also writers in the space who produce work of truly astonishing quality. But fanfiction is an alternate space specifically for people to explore a hobby without the kinds of judgment mainstream publication brings. Of course, that necessarily means that if you deliberately take a work out of that space and pursue mainstream publication, that discretion would immediately cease to apply. Anyway, in these communities, fans reconstruct published works together, reinterpreting characters and their situations to something that fans want more. Often that reinterpretation reduces interesting work into something that fits a pre-desired mold, and I don't feel great about that, but fanfiction writers will remind you that they just as often are writing for themselves the stories they don't see much in movies or TV. Either way, that kind of reinterpretation is noticeable in certain stock forms, like when a petulant, spoiled teenager who's too much of a fuck-up for even the fantasy racists to really want him is reimagined as a brooding, hot, damaged loner with a dark side, but also a fiercely protective streak. Or when a narcissistic asshole who happens to be reasonably good at logical deduction is reimagined as a brooding, hot, damaged loner with a dark side, but also a fiercely protective streak. Or when a mass-murdering, self-obsessed space fascist who's crossed every point of no return possible is reimagined as a brooding, hot, damaged loner with a dark side, but also a fiercely protective streak. Or when a brooding, hot, damaged loner with a dark side, but also a fiercely protective streak is... Okay, that one's pretty fair. Master of the Universe is hetfic. It depicts a male-female relationship, so I won't have much time to talk about slashfic, fanfiction that depicts male-male relationships, and which is vastly more popular, because straight women are the dominant demographic in the community, and they like to make their favorite fictional boys kiss. I just want to note that with more popular slashfic present as a more fantasized way to express straight women's interests, hetfic can have something of a reputation of being vanilla, as if those readers and writers are sticking to the shallow end of the fanfic fantasy pool. I think that reputation's unfair and kind of mean-spirited, but it's hard not to think of it reading something like Master of the Universe that claims to be lecherous and is actually pretty tame. And I also want to note that even in slashfic, the basic dynamic where one character is reimagined as the ingenue and the other is the beast, is still just as common. Master of the Universe, on the other hand, doesn't reimagine the characters that way because Bella and Edward are already like that. Master of the Universe does something a little more troubling.
From Isabella Swan. Subject: Stalker. Date: 29 May 2009, 8:36. To Edward Cullen. Have you sought therapy for your stalker tendencies? Bella.
But I do want to point out two big issues in the space. First, fanfiction presents as a safe space for women and queer people, especially young, bookish, introverted, socially isolated women and queer people, but it lacks any real mechanisms for protecting children or targets of harassment and abuse because, operating in a social and legal limbo, it lacks any substantive governance. Actors and authors are much less hostile to fanfiction than they used to be, but they face both practical and legal obstacles to getting involved in the space. The social media platforms that host fan communities like Tumblr exercise very limited oversight, both because they're social media platforms and because the community is generally hostile to those platforms, primed by how often those platforms and their predecessors have used specific crackdowns to target fan communities more broadly. And the Organization for Transformative Works, which runs AO3, the primary fanfiction repository, focuses on protecting the space from external legal threats. So the prospects for any real governance are slim. Unsurprisingly, bullying, harassment, and coordinated hostility are common and sometimes lionized. Even more concerning, consider that the space is semi-anonymous, appeals to socially isolated people, features a wide age distribution that includes adults and children, places a lot of emphasis on internal social rank, and is sexually charged. Lacking oversight, this is exactly the kind of community we would identify as a potential haven for more direct kinds of abuse. And without direct governance, that's hard to track, but preliminary efforts have suggested that cyberstalking and other dangerous behavior is indeed prevalent in the space. In a more limited respect, these dynamics also accord a lot of social power to an amateur writer like Snow Queen's Ice Dragon, someone who, in the best of lights, was publicly prickly about criticism, enjoying their sudden social status, and lacking any preparation or support to manage the responsibility that suddenly influential voice confers. Second, explicit fanfiction reaches readers that are romantically and sexually inexperienced, in general, or with the specific acts described. That's kind of the point, but it imposes a responsibility on the writer to be careful. They can do that in different ways, by showing these acts unsafely, by using elevated tone to be clear about the level of fantasy involved, by depicting the negative consequences attached. But fanfiction writers are amateurs, and many of them simply won't have the skill to do that or even conceptualize the need to do that. That's the test Master of the Universe most obviously fails. Many fanfiction readers are surprised by the story's fame because, well, what Bella and Edward get up to just isn't that out there. But that's what's so important. By having these banal characters with banal personalities and banal interests do this stuff in such a banal way.
My inner goddess frowns at me. You can do this, she coaxes. Play this sex god at his own game. Can I? Okay, what to do? My inexperience an albatross around my neck. I pick up a spear of asparagus, gazing at him. I bite my lip, and then very slowly put the tip of my cold asparagus in my mouth and suck it.
Master of the Universe becomes less safe than a work that's more clear that it's pure fantasy. Even so, it is true that Master of the Universe is one bad fanfic in an informal, alternative space where we should try to be hands-off about imposing judgments of quality, right? In 2011, Erica Mitchell pulled Master of the Universe offline and published it through Australian niche publisher The Writer's Coffee Shop as 50 Shades of Grey. The connection was exposed pretty quickly because, well, they're the same story. Romance author Jane Litt ran 50 Shades and Master of the Universe through a plagiarism checker, which identified an 89% similarity, which, having been a teacher, is the kind of result you get when a student takes a previously submitted essay and changes the header and title. In this case, most of the changes are the new character names. Bella becomes Anastasia Steele, Edward becomes Christian Grey, and side characters like Jacob Rose and Esme become Jose, Kate, and Grace, as well as fixes to spelling and punctuation. Many of the brand names have been changed. Most of the cars in the book are now Audis. Some of Mitchell's British profanity has been softened for American readers. In a few places, Christian's tastes have been elevated from gaudily middle class to something a little more refined, and a couple of the most egregious sentences have been tidied up. The closest thing to a real upgrade, by far, is the replacement of Mitchell's massive overuse of ellipses with appropriate punctuation, which does make the literal sentences easier to literally read. Now, that fiction, as comical as it seems, is legally necessary. While fanfiction is probably legally protected under copyright law, that probably is doing a lot of rhetorical work in a space where the law can be very fickle, and that limited legal protection vanishes immediately when that fanfiction is sold commercially. That puts Mitchell and the writer's coffee shop in the position of making some light edits, telling a transparent fiction, and hoping that Stephanie Meyer didn't decide to push the issue legally, and luckily for them, she didn't. In the fanfiction world, this practice, which is more common now, is sometimes known as filing off the serial numbers. Internally, attitudes to doing this are mixed. Many people feel, well, get that back. If a writer worked hard to make something, and now they can make some money from it, they should take the opportunity. As we just discussed, it's not like it's uncommon for published writers to write lightly disguised reinterpretations of prior works. Why should fanfiction writers specifically be excluded only because they've shown their work? On the other hand, there's a lot of concern for the space, the illegal scrutiny and media attention this practice brings to a space by and for people who don't want that attention, especially as it relies on brand holders just to not be very litigious. Some people feel that the fact that any popular story might be pulled and republished for a different space harms the independence and authenticity of the space, makes it a sort of minor league for publication, and gets people to write fanfiction not to be a part of the community, but to jumpstart a real writing career. And there's fraternal concern for young writers who go this route without understanding the risks of permanently connecting your real identity to your teenaged internet pseudonym, or that getting one book published by a niche e-publisher is not the same thing as a writing career. For our purposes, the biggest issue is that severing the connection from 50 Shades back to Twilight just destroys the only way 50 Shades works at all. As Twilight fanfiction, the reader can track how Snow Queen's Ice Dragon rearranged characters and story beats. Separated from that context, all those characters and beats have to stand for themselves, and charitably, they don't. For example, early in Twilight, Bella's dad gets her an old used truck that comes to represent Bella's independence and lack of vanity, and she hangs on to it for 3 books until it's eventually replaced. A surprising amount of Master of the Universe is taken up by Edward replacing that truck with a Volvo he approves of, a change that just says a lot about what Mitchell is doing here, but a recognizable modification to the source material. But in 50 Shades, without that source material, they're just spending pages going over the mechanics of replacing a Volkswagen Beetle with an Audi, and the whole story arc comes off as completely unhinged on the part of every character involved. In Twilight, many of the female characters have blonde hair or other striking features because Bella, the ugly duckling, needs to feel overshadowed before she becomes the swan, and because they're mostly vampires, and Meyer gives them striking features to represent that. Mitchell inherits those characters from Twilight, but when the link is severed, it just becomes Mitchell surrounding Anna with evil blonde women for her to fixate on his sexual competitors. Issues like this are everywhere. The biggest, though, is what it does to Anna, Christian, and the relationship between them. We've already talked about the self-aware and sometimes cutting inner voice that Meyer gives Bella, and how that helps keep Twilight afloat. Well, cut off from that, Mitchell's Anna becomes possibly the most thoroughly dislikable viewpoint character I have ever encountered. Her traits are an unchecked materialism, a lack of willpower or goals, a fixation on propriety disconnected from any actual status or social ambition, an insipid social manner, a total lack of competence or intellectual curiosity on any subject that ever comes up, and an internal obsession with her own emotional gratification, which, again, we do not even directly experience because Mitchell offloads it all onto the dance moves of Anna's inner goddess.
My very small inner goddess sways in a gentle, victorious samba.
Like that.
My inner goddess is doing the merengue with some salsa moves.
Yeah, like that.
My inner goddess has stopped dancing and is staring too, mouth open, drooling slightly. My inner goddess is jumping up and down, clapping her hands like a 5-year-old. My inner goddess jumps up and down with cheerleading pom-poms, shouting yes at me.
Okay, I'll stop.
My inner goddess is doing backflips in a routine worthy of a Russian Olympic gymnast.
Okay, now I'll stop. My point is, being inside Anna's head is like being crushed to death by a trash compactor. And then there's Christian. So, here's the thing about Christian. Edward Cullen is immortal, and he's spending his eternity going to high school. On purpose. The thing about Twilight is, it's decently written, fairly compelling. I think it's inappropriate to judge someone in its target audience who reads it and likes it. But it's like a Tom Clancy thriller. Read it, like it if you like it, but please don't let it into your worldview. When you start to pull on all those annoying complaints, what you find threading them all together is deeply unpleasant. Yes, Edward, being 100 years old and spending his time in a high school falling for a 17-year-old girl. Bella, being a passive character in her own story, and an increasingly empty one as the stories go on. And the male characters being the only ones who actually do anything. Jacob, imprinting on a baby. A lot of the thrill of the paranormal romance is that the fantasy can elevate the, well, fantasy. Edward's dark secret is not a family tragedy, not a first wife locked away in the attic. He's a literal vampire. Jacob's violent temper is represented as being a literal werewolf. This is a genre touchstone. It's very effective, and we see something like it in a lot of genres. For example, in the relationship that cyberpunk has to neo-noir. But in Twilight, when you untangle what the paranormal fantasy is heightening, see the world it's fantastically representing, you have to notice that the central romantic conflict is about a high school girl caught between, on the one hand, an exotic Native American dude who's buff and supportive but also has an uncontrollable violent temper, and on the other hand, a rich, older, asocial loner who's really into teenage girls because of their, blood. I'm sorry, yes, we do have to notice that. There are pieces of this stuff that are parts of the fantasy and pieces that aren't, but we do have to notice this because of what it adds up to. Twilight describes a world in which basically every man, everywhere, from strangers to enemies to other people in her class to her closest friends, are, in their hearts, predators obsessed with the sexuality of young women. And it doesn't even take that and say, so be independent, or so protect yourself, or so it's going to be tough, but you have to learn to stand up on your own. It's essentially clear that it thinks a woman's only role in her own story is then to select the man who feels the most noble guilt about that impulse and settle down with him and help him redeem himself for that sin by being with her. And like I said, you know, check your fire. Evaluate within proportion. There are pieces of this that are just elevations of a fantasy, and bear that in mind if that's just not your fantasy. To Meyer's credit, she balances this worldview a bit with, at least in the earlier stories, that keen sense of Bella's inner life. Her constant efforts to push back against Edward's behavior and insist on building a relationship in which he respects her and her desire to be on an even footing with him, even in a world that can't recognize their equality. That's something of a tradition in romance that goes back at least to Austen, the sense that the male and female roles in the world might be different and unequal, but the relationship between one man and one woman should be based on equal respect between each other.
You see, he and I are... He and I are so similar.
Obviously, that's more troubling in a story specifically made for 21st century teenage girls, but there is a literary history there. More than anything, That is the focus of 50 Shades' reinterpretation. Mitchell doesn't respond to Bella's willfulness, her pushback, and so she either removes it or turns it into a storytelling obstacle where her brief objections are errors that Christian has to overcome. Twilight's Edward, like many a male lead of a romance novel, is a brooding, hot, damaged loner with a dark side, but also a fiercely protective streak. 50 Shades' Christian isn't that. Christian is an abuser. What happens when people talk about this is that the conversation gets sucked into talking specifically about the BDSM and the sex. So I want to be clear, Christian is abusive way before they get to the sex. Immediately after their first meeting, he stalks her to her workplace, surprises her there, and behaves inappropriately there. He finds out where she lives, and he hacks her phone so he can track her location. Later, he replaces her phone with a BlackBerry that he bought and set up for her. He uses his financial status to exert steadily increasing control over her life, replacing her computer with one he's gotten, making her use an email account he set up for her, and replacing her car with one he's bought for her. Later, he'll buy the company she works at so he can manage her work life, too.
You bought the company I work for. This isn't a relationship, Christian.
He monitors her contact with her friends and controls when and how much she sees them. He makes her follow a diet he lays out. He replaces her clothing with clothing that he prefers. He monitors her sexual history and makes her see a doctor that he knows and she doesn't for a medical exam, and so that he can make her use a kind of contraception that he approves of. You'll be shocked to hear that he doesn't like condoms. He leverages an NDA to pressure her not to discuss their relationship with her best friend or her mother, so that the only person she can talk to about any of his behavior is him. He pressures her to sign a sex contract entitling him to perform acts she's not entirely comfortable with, including outright refusing to accept some of the limits she sets, without explaining to her that the contract doesn't have legal force. That's actually a recurring element, Christian putting Anna in situations that she has no experience with, leveraging her experience to get things from her that she's uncomfortable with, and then, if she calls him on it, blaming her for allowing him to behave that way. Sometimes he just ignores the limits she sets, and sometimes he threatens to violate her limits so she'll give in on whatever he wants in the moment. Literally anything Anna needs, wants, or isn't really able to turn down, he leverages to extend his control over her life and to cut off her ability to take independent action that he can't monitor.
Christian, how do you have my bank information?
At the point that ends the first book, Christian finally does one thing she can't accept. Anna decides to break off their arrangement and goes to storm out, and she literally realizes that she can't. She doesn't have the practical ability to separate her life from his. She retreats to her bedroom in his home, and when he then comes in to talk to her, without being invited, obviously, she actually gives in again, willing to continue their relationship if he acknowledges that she has feelings for him and doesn't do that one thing again. He won't agree to that, so she has to financially negotiate their breakup, asking for him to reimburse her for the old car he made her get rid of, because she doesn't have a car anymore. It's his car. She doesn't have a laptop. It's his laptop. She doesn't have a phone. It's his phone. And then she needs his driver to take her home. Incidentally, that breakup lasts for 3 days. Then Christian impresses her with his monetary wealth, steamrolls her into going on an expensive date, negs her.
Those beautiful eyes look too large in your face, Isabella.
Drags her into an alley and kisses her, takes her to an expensive restaurant, and, of course, blames her for allowing him to hurt her. Then they resume the relationship they had before, except now, instead of there being rules he might break, he'll do whatever he wants and she just has to trust him. He explicitly says they'll work back up to doing what he did before. What I'm trying to say is Christian's only character trait is abusiveness. It's a textbook depiction. He uses every one of his advantages to pressure her. He finds every imbalance in their relationship and exploits them against her. What's actually wild about it is that the only thing that obscures this at all is that Anna is so unsympathetic. The story teaches the reader that Anna is always wrong about what she wants. Her objections are surface level. She never sustains them for more than a day or two, and she's always ultimately happy with whatever Christian wants. The reader comes to recognize that the logic of the story is that Anna's feelings are automatically invalid if they conflict with Christian's desires. In an incredibly specific sense, it's a story in which an asshole and an idiot exchange page after page of the world's least sexy, dirty emails.
From Edward Cullen. Subject: Your Issues. Date: 27 May 2009, 1:27. To Isabella Swan. Dear Miss Swan, following my more thorough examination of your issues, may I bring to your attention the definition of submissive, quoted here from dictionary.com.
Well, that brings us back to, well, Edward Cullen is immortal, and he's spending his eternity going to high school on purpose. I can only think of two kinds of immortality, of eternal preservation of ourselves. The real one, the longevity of our real selves, will not be achieved in my lifetime. Thus, we are denied the opportunity to be all the ourselves that we suspect we would have liked to be. I would have liked to also have lived a life where I was... Well, I'm sure you have many of your own endings to that sentence. Edward Cullen is immortal, and he... Failing that, we have only the immortality of our public selves, of our shades. Only the hope of carving our initials on the tree of culture, chiseling our faces into the rock faces so they never fade, lifting ourselves on the pier above Oblivion's tide. Emily Dickinson did not write this poem. Emily Dickinson wrote, "Above Oblivion's tide, there is a pier," but she didn't write this poem. Translating Dickinson's work for publication is a difficult task. For one thing, her handwriting was not great. Many of the poems are written on scraps of paper much smaller than the lines she was writing, so it's not always easy to tell where she intended a line break to be. The editor often has to infer words based on what words appear elsewhere in her usage and build out lines that match her meter. That's the easy part, because Dickinson commonly left in alternative word choices, like this "the" for Anne, that make changes, some subtle and some drastic, to her work. As an aside, since only one picture of Dickinson survives, I'm going to have to show you something else. So here, have some clips from the 2018 show Dickinson. It's, slightly fictionalized.
Poem's gonna get published.
But then that's the point. At this point, if you know a little about Emily Dickinson, you probably know that I've buried the lead here. The reason for all this uncertainty is that Dickinson didn't publish her poetry. Of Dickinson's 1,800 poems, only 10, half a percent, were published in her lifetime, three in a poetry collection intended to raise funds for the Union Army during the Civil War, the other seven published without Dickinson's direct approval by her friends in the literary world who received the poems as correspondence. In all cases, word choices, punctuation, sometimes whole lines were changed by editors to make her meaning simpler and her grammar more conventional. And then, when her work was thus reduced, critics criticized her meanings for being too pat, her meters for being too rote. Frustrated, Dickinson, initially ambivalent, came to reject publication, and only one poem is known to have been published with her direct consent. Success is Counted Sweetest, the one you might have read in school. Dickinson availed herself of the same networks that Stephanie Meyer did, that Erica Mitchell would write into as Snow Queen's Ice Dragon, writing on letters and scraps of paper for family and finding literary-minded friends around the country. Many of these people were prominent in the American literary scene and they recognized her talent, but Dickinson preferred to write to them privately. I'm afraid I've misled you slightly. Emily Dickinson didn't write this poem either. Below the first version of the poem, Dickinson has written two possible revisions, one replacing the last line, one replacing the last two and a half lines, both of which soften or reverse the meaning.
Above Oblivion's tide there is a pier, and in a faceless few are scattered there. Scattered, I say, to see them side by side. Enough will not be found when all have died. Emily Dickinson.
If Dickinson wrote one version, and then revisited it, to write a new version that complicates, perhaps even reverses the meaning? Does that mean she really meant the later one? Taken as it actually exists, Dickinson's poetry may seem even more revolutionary than it is as it was published. It can be seen as a masterpiece of poetic ambiguity. Every time she deliberates between a definite or an indefinite article, it could be taken as an opportunity to meditate on just how important these word choices are, how the whole poem can be shifted by switching "and" for "the." This is more romantic, but it's still incorrect. The work appears unfinished because it's unfinished. It's unfinished because it was not composed for publication. And yet here it is. I found mixed reports about whether Dickinson requested that all her personal papers be destroyed after her death, or only her correspondence, which would have also contained much of her poetry. Either way, she certainly left no instruction that her work be published, and had resisted mass distribution of her work in her lifetime, and yet her closest literary confidant, T.W. Higginson, and her sister Lavinia worked to have her work collected and published, yes, softening her punctuation, changing her language, and simplifying her meanings the whole way. Along the way, they, their successors, and the public reconstructed Dickinson's person, transforming a wealthy woman known for rarely venturing out and preferring to correspond by letter than to travel, beset in her lifetime by constant grief, into the form of that, the genre of author that we recognize. The tormented recluse, trapped in her solitude by a genius that cannot be understood, a narrative that incidentally recasts Higginson, Lavinia, and their successors as the heroic saviors of all this great art. Recovering Dickinson, finding all her poetry and trying to render and understand it in as accurate a manner as possible, is a project 150 years after her death. But the people who endeavor to salvage her work from what was done to it have to contend with an uncomfortable reality, that the work, no matter how accurately it's reconstructed, can't be fully understood as published, realized poetry. That's not what they are. And the person we make when we read them, the Dickinson that we construct through that poetry, that's not her either. It's someone she didn't want to make. Edward Cullen is immortal. I find the myself of 5 years ago an alien creature. I remember that he felt that way about the himself of 5 years before. I hope that in 5 years I feel again the same way. It's how I know I am capable of growth. And yet I am, right here, creating a performance of this me, the one I hope becomes a stranger, because it's the only thing I can come up with to do. Stephanie Meyer had a dream that turned into a personal project that she showed her sister, that turned into a global phenomenon. It made her famous, and it made her plenty of money. She kept writing, but nothing captured the public's attention like Twilight did. I wonder whether she's entirely comfortable with having this shadow of herself ensconced above Oblivion's tide. Erica Mitchell had a fanfic that turned into a small print run at a vanity publisher, that turned into a mass market phenomenon, that turned into a film series. It made her famous too, and it made her plenty of money too. She kept writing too, but nothing captured the public's attention like 50 Shades did. I wonder whether she's entirely comfortable with having this shadow of herself ensconced above Oblivion's tide. Maybe Dickinson had the right idea all those years ago, seeing what this quest for immortality really was, choosing instead to share her work with her friends, with people who might see them as her work. And then some of those same friends waited until she couldn't object anymore, and did exactly what she didn't want. Sanded down her work for mass consumption, and submitted it for the attention of people who didn't know her. And here I am. This video won't make me immortal, but for you, it has already created a me. A person that you imagine would come to say these words, that will live longer in your mind than I ever will. And I did that on purpose, even if, in the moment I write this, I don't quite know why. The real Stephanie Meyer, and the real Erica Mitchell, and the real Emily Dickinson, and the real you and me, will all be washed out on Oblivion's tide one day. But Edward Cullen is immortal. Oh, and the 50 Shades movies. They're better than the books, enough that I felt a little bad using movie clips to talk about the books. The first one softens Christian's character, lets Anna have a little pushback and something of a voice, and manages the frankly excellent casting of Jamie Dornan and Dakota Johnson, all choices that pay off across the whole trilogy. Like, in this scene in the books, right after they've broken up, Christian bombards Anna with gifts and then gets her to accept a relationship in which she actually has even less power than she did before. But in the movie, Anna makes demands, and he concedes. It's still not a good scene, but it does work at a very basic level. The first movie also succeeds in imposing something like a plot structure and arc onto the story, which is an accomplishment. But there's just nothing in the source material to work with. You can't build a house out of quicksand, and you can't make a good movie out of this text. Anyway, thanks for getting this far. I know you're eager to go watch another one of my videos, but before you do, remember that it does help if you hit the like button, subscribe, even offer a friendly comment.